Okay, what we're going to talk about today, I'm going to give you an overview of what the coalition is and what the regulation, the laws that are put in place that are resulting or in us being in this program. I'm going to talk about what we are as an organization and equally important, what we are not. We're not a commodity group or farm bureau type organization. We also have, there's membership requirements to be a part of this. The term I'm going to be using several times in this meeting is this is a group permit. We created the ability for you all to be in compliance with the water board requirements by doing it as a group. You have an option to do it individually. You knock yourself out if you want to do it. It's very expensive. The dairy industry has individual permits, and if you know any dairymen and want to hear some really sob stories, ask them about their waste discharge requirements, because they don't have the ability to do these in a group permit. So I want to talk about also some of the requirements that we have in the waste discharge requirement. At WDR is the shorthand term I'm going to use a lot today. Talk about the groundwater assessment report. We've done a pretty large evaluation of the information on groundwater in this county and the other four counties we're in, and talk about the vulnerability designations we've now proposed to the regional board through a hydrogeologist report where the vulnerability areas are to groundwater contamination and the low vulnerability areas. And then next is the nitrogen management plan. We are going to get in the business of reporting nitrogen fertilizer, not just the East San Joaquin Coalition. All the farmers in the Central Valley within a year are going to be reporting nitrogen fertilizer applications. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about where that all is and how we got up to where the report form is at this point, see how that was developed. And then also talk about the farm evaluation. I suspect many, if not all of you, have done these farm evaluations. Kind of give you some of the summary results of that and talk a little bit about how we're going to go forward with that. And then Mike's going to talk about the 2013 surface water monitoring. Even though it was a dry year, we did have some waterways that were running that we had to sample. And then throughout the meeting, if you've got any questions or need some clarification, don't hesitate to stop me and ask for clarification so we can make sure everybody understands what we're talking about here. So a question we get a lot, and this may be the first time many of you have been to one of these irrigated lands programs, you know, where on earth did this come from? Who dreamed this up? Well, you can trace it back to the 1970s and the Richard Nixon administration. That's when the Clean Water Act was passed. And that act was passed on a national level, and it was primarily developed or initiated to go after water treatment plants, the sewer plants, factories that were discharging into surface water, because at that time, none of that was regulated. So the Clean Water Act was passed with those industries and those discharges of surface water in mind. Agriculture was not even considered at that time. They were not considered a major problem. So they put us off to the side for decades, actually. And when that regulation was passed, the federal government said to each of the states, you can either follow US EPA, let us be your regulatory entity, or you states can create your own statewide regulatory authority on water quality. State of California had two legislators, last names were Porter and Colon. They passed legislation in the 70s that in effect put in place our own state water control act. And the enforcer, the implementer of that act is the State Water Resources Control Board. And I often refer to them as the mothership. They're the state water board that handles both surface water supplies and ground and surface water quality. Two different areas. We don't get involved in supply at all in our coalition or our activities. It's totally focused on quality. So they created this Port of Colon Water Quality Act. State Water Board then had the state divided up in the regions. So there's now 9 regional water boards around the state. We are in the Central Valley Regional Water Quality Control Board. Central Coast has a regional board. LA, San Francisco area. There's 9 regional boards around the state. Each has their own little authorities and their own regulations that apply to the industry and agriculture in those areas. So when we started out in 2003 with our program, we had a waiver of waste discharge requirements. That's only a term of art, really, because the regulations haven't changed a lot. But we had complete waivers up until 2000. And the legislature got rid of those waivers. They said agriculture and a couple other industries, no more waivers. You got to have waste discharge requirements. So the Regional Water Board adopted for us in 2003 a waiver of waste discharge requirements, a conditional waiver. The conditions were such that it was just as well as been a waste discharge permit. So involved in that was surface water primarily. Groundwater was known to be an eventual area of regulation, but at that time in 2003, they said we're gonna put this off until later, until we get this program in place. So the program that we're in now is called the Irrigated Lands Regulatory Program. You see that a lot. It applies to all of the Central Valley, all the counties in the Central Valley, encompasses both surface and groundwater. As I mentioned, when the program started in 2003, it was only related to surface water discharges, potential discharge of stormwater or potential irrigation runoff. And potential is a key word here because most of us don't have stormwater drainage, but what they were using as a standard was a 100-year storm. If you have water running off your farm, then you have the potential to discharge stormwater. So they kind of threw the blanket over the Central Valley, and it was not 100% of growers needed to be covered by the program. So when they added groundwater, though, they said, okay, if you don't have a potential to discharge the surface water, then you certainly have the potential to discharge the groundwater through either stormwater infiltration or irrigation infiltration into groundwater. So now everybody that's in commercial agriculture has to have coverage either through a coalition or through the individual general order or individual permit, similar to what the dairy guys have. So all these versions, be it an individual program or a coalition program, has three main elements. You gotta meet water quality standards, you've gotta do the monitoring to prove you're meeting those standards, and then you have to do the reporting that justifies that you are doing the reporting. You have a choice. You can still go into an individual program. The main difference between them is that you, as an individual, are responsible for all the reports to the water board that we do as a coalition on your behalf. The dairymen right now are spending anywhere from $10,000 to $30,000 a year to write the reports for their dairy operations. And like I say, they don't have the option to join a coalition for the compliance like we do. And it takes specialists to write these reports. It isn't like you and I sit down and try to write a waste discharge requirement report for the regional board. They are very specialized documents. They have plans. You have to plan everything. You got to tell them when you're going to monitor, the time of the year you're going to monitor, how you're going to do this work. So they're very elaborate plans. And we hired MLJ, Mike Johnson's group, to do this for us on our behalf for the coalition. The other option is, and many of you all have done this, the vast majority of growers have joined water coalitions in the Central Valley. There started out to be seven of us organizations in place from Shasta, northern part of the valley, down to Kern County. When the groundwater was added, the single coalition from Fresno South split into seven coalitions. So now we have a grand total of 14 of these coalitions representing our landowners to the Regional Water Board with this group permit. So that's each of them is organized in a slightly different fashion. We're a nonprofit 501c5 organization. Some are managed by irrigation districts, some are managed by resource conservation districts. Go ahead.
I have several different properties, and my membership is based on properties that would drain into watersheds, which goes back to when this started several years ago. If I'm hearing this right, do all of my properties now need to join the...
Yes, you need to have anything that's commercial irrigated cropland needs to have coverage by one method or another, individually or in a coalition. And there's some of you, too, that came in were asking us about properties in Fresno County or in other areas. Unfortunately, that you're going to have to join those coalitions as well. We're hoping these meeting requirements can be fulfilled by coming to one here and you don't have to go to one down there. So I'm actually working for you all up here. I farm down in the Reedley area, so I'm a member of the coalition down in the Kings River area. But anyway, so that's the situation now going forward. The only exemption is if you're not commercial. If you got a pasture running a horse out there, you don't need to be in it. If you sell the horses or if you sell cattle off a pasture, then that's considered commercial and you need to be involved. And there's no acreage minimum either.
Is it okay to go ahead and put the new?
Yes, yeah, just talk to the young lady there when you checked in. Jennifer will get you set up there. And there's not any late fees or anything associated with that. I'll get to that later on folks that have joined late on what's involved with that. So when the regional board decided to change to waste discharge requirements, they committed to the coalitions in the valley that we're going to adopt individual coalition specific waste discharge requirements. The previous regulation, there was one regulation applied to the whole valley. There was no changes based on geography. If you were in Kern, it was the same as if you were in Shasta. So they said, all right, we'll adopt WDRs for each of the coalitions. Lucky us, we got to be the first one. Ours was adopted December 7th, 2012. Subsequent to that, the South Valley was adopted in September of 13. And then this past summer, all the rest of the coalitions got their waste discharge requirements. So what I'm going to be telling you the rest of this presentation, don't think it's just us. Everybody, it's an irrigated ag in the valley, has to do what we're talking about and going to be talking about today. The only difference of the other coalitions is their timelines are a little bit delayed from what ours are. Not by much, maybe a year, some are the same time, but that's a primary difference. So I mentioned that we're a nonprofit 501c5 organization. We started in 2003. We have about 4,000 members now with approximately 720,000 irrigated acres. There's about 1 million acres of irrigated cropland in this 5-county region. About 180,000 is in the dairy program. If a dairy has properties and they use it for manure, liquid manure disposal, they have to be on their dairy permit. And then there's about 20,000 acres now that is not in the coalition, and I'll talk a little bit about that, about what regional board's doing for that. But again, the term we use is a group permit. We're representing you on a group standpoint, and that's how we go forward. Our board is made up of growers, primarily growers. We've got all the Farm Bureau leads on our board of directors. Anya here from Madera County is on it. Merced County Farm Bureau, Amanda Carvajal is on it. We have growers. Our chairman is Alan Reynolds. He's a vineyard manager for Gallo. He has nothing to do with buying grapes, so doesn't do any good to gripe to Alan because he has to sell his too. And then Bill McKinney's an almond grower in the Modesto area. Bill Brush is a grower, a CCA certified crop advisor. And then we also have all the ag commissioners sitting in our meetings. They're not voting members, but they have been good advisors to the group overall in the things that we've been doing. But what their regulatory authority doesn't apply to the activities that we are doing. And then we have a very flat amount of staffing. We own no buildings. We have no assets. We're a virtual organization. Our administrative office is at the Modesto Farm or Stanislaus County Farm Bureau. I'm a 1099 employee, as are our contractors. Jennifer Sanchez, that you saw in here, she's a contractor with us as well. We don't work full-time for the coalition because there's not full-time activities. We don't figure putting people on payroll and salary is worth your money. It's not an efficient way to run it, so we run it in this fashion. We feel it's a very effective way to keep the dues down and keep the growers in compliance. So it's also important to understand what we aren't. Because when we started this group in 2003, we got a lot of people saying, what are you starting another farm group? There's enough farm groups around. Why do you need to do this? Well, because the charge and the activities that we do are unlike any commodity group or organization, be it irrigation district, in other words, wise, have ever had to do in assistance of farmers. Now, in other areas, some of the districts have taken it over, but when we started in 2003, Madera ID, Merced ID, Stanislaus, or Modesto ID, Turlock ID, want to have nothing to do with this. So the farm bureaus and some growers said, we got to have something to represent growers, so we started this organization. But we are not a commodity group. Obviously, we have every commodity in our area. We're not a farm organization. We don't lobby. We don't get involved in elections. We don't get involved in state county any kind of raises. Our sole goal in life is to represent you to the regional water board, and that's what we're about. So we hold this group permit. We try to operate as efficiently as we can, try to keep our costs as low as we can, and oftentimes have to provide tough information to our board and members to make decisions related to these regulations that are on top of us. One thing that we have changed on the organization based on when the new order was passed is we've changed our bylaws to make this an organization where the board of directors are elected. And the reason we did that is because some of the other coalition growers were complaining that we don't know who the coalition is, we don't know where our dues are going, you know, if we don't like it, how are we going to make any changes? Well, we've adjusted our bylaws to try to I guess, assist on that, and then have elections. And our new bylaws are posted on our website, were adopted in January, and we're gonna start our new board elections next year. But the other things you can expect going forward is we're gonna have a lot more outreach, these types of events. Also, as fertilizer reporting gets forward, a lot more assistance in getting that in place. Okay, so the dues for the organization. 3 years ago, we were $4 an acre with the increased acreage that we came in with a groundwater program. We've been able to stop the dues from going up. In fact, backed off by a 25 cents an acre. We've got the ability, if you want, to pay e-check or credit card. New members that come into the coalition, this was a very contentious issue with our board. We had one quarter of the board that said, we've been in this thing since 2004. Anybody that comes in, they pay from 2004 to the present. Then we had another group that said, let's just get the growers in, forget about these back dues. Well, the former lost out, and they kind of came to a middle ground and said, all right, if somebody joins from this point, they're going to have to pay member initiation fees. So if somebody joins today, it's $12.75 per acre plus $50 membership. And the reason for that, the rationale the board used was, look, we've been putting money in this organization for 10 years. Why should somebody that blew this thing off all of a sudden be able to come in and not pay back dues? So this was kind of a back dues, if it would have been paid fully, would have been about $20 an acre for someone. So it's right now it's $12.75. And then if you got an enforcement letter from the regional board, they're sending letters out to landowners with APNs that are not in our member database. They also have to pay the state a $200 fee. And the regional board is active enforcement in tracking down people that are, and more or less asking them, you're going to get an individual permit or are you going to join a coalition? In fact, they've mailed out thousands of letters, and there's been some actions taken in the last 6 months. They filed their first ACLs, administrative civil liability fines, against people who did not respond to, there was a postcard, there was a letter, there was a certified letter, and if those individuals didn't act, then this regional board filed these ACLs against them, one in each of the, or a couple in Madera County, but two, one in Merced and one in Modesto, so they're beginning this action in the East San Joaquin area, because again, our order was the first one to be adopted. We expect these things are going to be popping up all over the Central Valley. We have still about 20,000 acres that are not in the coalition. Now, whether they go to this level of fines, it's unknown. I tell you, if you have a friend that gets one of these, tell them to respond to it. These guys are like the IRS. It seems like they're just invisible. You never hear from them. All of a sudden, you get this letter from me, and you're in violation in thousands of dollars worth of fines. So I encourage you to have people that are not participating in this to get us. I mean, I'm right there with you and talking to a gentleman before. We don't like this regulation. We don't like to be here having to deal with this. I sit on a group, it's called CV Salts up in Sacramento. We're trying to change the salt standard in the valley. And I sit at the table with City of Sacramento, City of Stockton, Woodland, Davis, all these cities, and plus us Aggies in a room, Derry included, and we piss and moan and gripe about the program, and they just smirk at us and say, get used to it. We've been doing this for 30 years dealing with these people. This is the way it is to live with the regional water boards. So they've tried as hard as they can to get rid of these regulations. They're still in place. They're getting more strict is what they're doing. So it's an unfortunate regulatory program, but we feel like this group approach is the most cost-effective way to be in compliance with these waste discharge requirements. So the growers that have these fines, there's negotiation ability to go through their proposed, pay the proposed ACL, ask for a hearing, contest the complaint. And, you know, the outcomes of these are still in progress. We don't know what, you know, where they're going to go, how the region board's going to land. Unfortunately, we're the first, again, these are the first to come out. So those that are in the position to have to deal with these are going to be the first ones that are going to face the regional board and how they're going to land on these. Okay, so the requirements of this new order, again, this is everybody in the Central Valley is going to have to comply with this. The first thing they're going to need to do is complete the farm evaluation. Most of you, or if all of you, have gotten this already. The other thing is, and I'll go over some of the results that we got from the farm evaluation. The second is completing the nitrogen management plan. We're in the middle of developing the template for that plan right now. I'll show you what we submitted to the regional board last week. And then those in a highly erodible areas, we don't have much in Madera County, we'll have to develop a sediment and erosion control plan. Again, we have a template for that. And then you'll fill that out, keep it on the farm. You don't have to turn it into anybody. Well, let me back up. The farm evaluation has to come to the coalition. We aggregate it. The nitrogen management plan will come to us once a year. We'll aggregate it. Sediment erosion control plan, you fill it out and you leave it in case there's an inspection, you show it to an inspector. In this area, in Madera County, the only cropland that's going to need these is maybe right by the foothills where you got the rolling hill properties, and then Merced, Stanislaus County, east of the Oakdale Waterford Highway. All that new ground being developed, they're going to all need sediment erosion control plans. And then smaller operations, 60 and under, for a membership, 60 and under, we'll have more time to fill out these forms. And then the last one, the last and not least, is participate in an outreach meeting. You don't know how many times we went round and round with the regional board telling, what are you nuts? 4,000 people go into a meeting a year, this is never gonna happen. So we lost though. They said, this is a complicated new permit. If growers don't hear about it somewhere, how are they gonna find out about it? Because it isn't publicized generally very widely. So we lost. And they said, if they got a WDR permit, they're gonna need to go to an outreach meeting a year, especially in the first couple of years as these new requirements are rolled out. So the video is gonna help us, so you don't have to come in here in the room in the afternoons and sweat through these things. We'll hopefully facilitate that and do whatever we can with media to help you fulfill this requirement. Okay, so our order passed in 2012. We started work on the things that we have to do as a coalition. Every coalition had to reapply to the water board to be the coalition. Every single one of them that had been in place, we were in place for 10 years, had to reapply to be the third party representative. We were, our approval was granted after about a month. And then we worked with a template, or with the coalitions, to develop the farm evaluation template. We've been working on the nitrogen template with the coalitions. We started our groundwater and almost finished our groundwater assessment report. This is a huge document developed by a hydrogeologist firm that we hired. And each coalition's gonna have to do this for the region. We spent close to $250,000 on this, and what it essentially is a huge data dump of all the groundwater monitoring data collected over the past 10 years in this region, soils information, depth to groundwater, nitrate levels, all that information is put into a report. And out of that report then comes the vulnerability designations. That's mostly if you're shallow groundwater, high nitrates, and sandy ground, you're going to be in a high vulnerability area as a rule of thumb. There's other exceptions, and Mike Johnson will go into that in a little more detail. So those are the primary things that we've been working on since the order was passed. So another thing I wanted to back up and talk about a little, because you're probably wondering, or if you haven't heard, why there's so much focus on nitrates in groundwater. This is not a recent issue that popped up out of the blue. There's been a lot of things building on this. When we started this program in 2003, the regional board said, we're gonna just do surface water, we'll do groundwater later. So we always kind of knew it was coming. At that time, 10 years ago, there was indications of high nitrates around the valley. And then in 2012, a report from UC Davis written by Thomas Harder came out, and it was like throwing a cluster bomb in Sacramento. This thing came out condemning agriculture for causing contamination especially this was focused on Tulare Lake Basin and Salinas Valley. And one of the key findings of this report was that 40% of the fertilizer we put on our cropland goes into groundwater. When the regional board saw that out of a UC report, it's just like it set them off. Like, we have got to start regulating fertilizer. The other thing that came about in the 90s, 2000s, you didn't hear much about, was the disadvantaged community lobby. This makes the environmentalists and the greenies look weak in comparison. These are very political, powerful organizations that are in Sacramento that have the legislature's ear, and they've been spending the last 3 years trying to get laws passed to tax fertilizer. And essentially, they want to tax fertilizer, put it in a fund for all these disadvantaged communities, low-income communities, to get replacement water, drill new wells, get bottled water, some source of replacement of the water allegedly contaminated by nitrate fertilizers. So these three things kind of hit a perfect storm, and then the regional board got hold of it and they said these WDRs are going to be very strict on nitrogen reporting and all the factors related to nitrogen use in crops. So this was all last about a year ago when this all hit. We actually, because of our being first, we're going to have to start reporting fertilizer this year. 2014 crop was the first year we were going to have to do it. Because of all these things going on, they postponed that for a year. So the tracking, the monitoring of fertilizer now is going to start in 2015 crop year. And then you'll report to us in 2016 what you did in 2015. And I'll go to some details into how that's going to work in a minute. So out of that Thomas Harder report, there were some recommendations to the State Water Board that needed to be done. Two things that they recommended was that CDFA, Department of Food and Agriculture, create a task force to figure out how do farmers report fertilizer? How are they going to do this? Because obviously we haven't ever had to do that in farming. There's no template out there for us to follow. So that was one thing. And then there was an expert panel required to be formed to answer some of the scientific questions that come up about, okay, so we know how much fertilizer goes on our field, how do you measure it going into groundwater? How do you know what the impact would be? So those were two efforts that were started. And I'll just go over those briefly because it's going to be kind of one of these too much information things. But the reason I'm talking about this is the groundwork for what we're going to have to do forever with fertilizer. And it's good to understand these two things that are setting the groundwork for that. Go ahead.
Is the report that the Eastside Coalition available to members or is it a public document? Does that have to be made available to the public?
The information you turn in to us?
Well, the information garnered from the report.
That will be public. It's not finalized yet, but we're going to post it on our website. You mean the groundwater assessment report?
Yes.
Yeah, that's going to be posted on our website.
All the work you guys have been doing on our behalf, is that public?
It's not really public. We put it in, I mean, if somebody wants to go to the water board, do a freedom of information request, they can get it. And we put things on our members only site, but it's not, we don't send press releases out when our annual reports are done. So if somebody really wants to get anything that we file with the water board, it's publicly available. But what our reporting for fertilizer is going to be, and I'll get into this in a bit, is we're going to aggregate it on the township. We're not turning in every one of your fertilizer reports. We're going to aggregate them and give township reports. We convinced the regional board that it didn't do any good to have 4,000 fertilizer reports from growers because they couldn't understand, you know, they couldn't make any assumptions from that. Okay, so again, the reason I'm going through these is because this is going to be, I remember when the task force and the expert panel, because this is setting the groundwork for what we're going to have to do, what our grandkids are going to have to do on reporting a nitrogen fertilizer. So I'm going to just go through here real quickly what happened with these. The task force was formed by CDFA, and just to back up a bit, CDFA is the only entity in the state that, so to speak, regulates fertilizer, and they don't really regulate it. What they do is when a Western Farm Service sells you, CPS now, sells you triple 15, they do the analysis to make sure it's 15%, 15, you know, they do that analysis and then they collect the sales from the fertilizer dealers per county. So that's all they're doing with fertilizer regulation, but they are kind of the parent of fertilizer. It's not Department of Pesticide Regulation. So anyway, Thomas Harder report said CDFA go out and figure out how growers should do this reporting. The task force had 28 entities. I was on it myself. There's UC people, regulators, university ag groups, the EJ community was there. So we met pretty much all of the summer of 2013 and came out with recommendations on tracking and reporting. And I'm only going to show you one thing. You can't read this, but the illustration is adequate to explain the outcome. And the outcome was, first, growers, we're down here at the bottom. Here's the state water board. So the growers track what they do. The recommendation was growers track what you're doing throughout the year. And it's some of these meetings were incredible. They think nobody tracks fertilizer out. But anyway, the point is they said, okay, growers track the information on their farm here at the bottom, and then they report the information up to the third parties, coalitions, data aggregators. So then we combine that information on our region, our coalition region, and then we report that to the regional boards, which is up here in an aggregated form. And then the regional boards report that up to the state board. And the bottom line question statement up there is the water quality getting better or is it getting worse? Right now, Brown goes in and asks these guys and they don't know what the answer is. And the state agencies, one thing they don't like is to not have the answer to a question like that. So part of what this whole program is gonna do someday, I don't know when, they're gonna be able to say things are getting better or they're getting worse. Surface water, we definitely know things are getting better as a result of our efforts. Groundwater, that's the big question mark right now. Okay, so switching to the expert panel. That was the main take of the task force. The expert panel then was made up mostly of scientists, hydrogeologists, there was a couple of CCA certified crop advisors, agronomists, two growers. It was directed by Charles Bird. He was the chair out of Cal Poly San Luis. And then the coalitions, the commodity groups, we are all an ag advisory group. We held our feet to the fire as much as we could throughout their process. They issued their final report in September to the state board. And I'm going to excerpt here some of the key recommendations that they came up with. Again, bear with me. This is the kind of things that are setting precedence. One of the things that they recommended is that the reporting be done in a ratio, not just total amount of nitrogen applied. And we see San Joaquin and some of us have been supportive of this because you think about it, if all we did was report the amount of nitrogen we put on, somebody is gonna take that number and say, okay, Thomas Harder said 40% goes into groundwater and there you go. Region board's gonna say, well, 40% of what you do is going into groundwater, so you need to cut back 40%. So what this does rightly is you put into the equation what production you get off of a field. Because obviously nitrogen is a consumptive use input. So when you put it on, your crop is using it. It consumes it to produce the end product. So what they recommended that be done is we figure out how to do a ratio to where you get 3,000 pounds of almonds, UC says 250 units, that's 1-to-1. So you're putting on what UC says is consumed by the crop, so you're good. If you put on 500 pounds and you get 2,500 pounds of almonds, you're clearly putting on more than research has shown that tree needs. That would be A2. So the idea with this is not to be an exact, but just kind of a gauge as to where you are compared to your like crops, and like areas with soil types. Now this ratio would be average over multiple years. It wouldn't be every year, this is what your ratio is, but the recommendation is to average it over a period of time. And I'm gonna go in a little bit more detail on that, but I think it's gonna be complicated, but I tell you, if we get stuck in this, how many pounds you put on agriculture, and it still is that much going to groundwater, it's just nothing but ugly for us going forward. Because you know how these statistics can be manipulated. And I've seen some of the tonnage reports, oh my gosh, the amount of fertilizer we put on, if you figure 1 million acres times 100 pounds, that's 100 million pounds of fertilizer put on. The numbers are gigantic. So we've got to have context to these numbers, and I think this is the way that we're going to be able to get that context. Okay, so one of the other things that they did recommend that we're really glad is they said, we got to figure out this ratio. We got to take some time, maybe take 5 years to figure out how do we do this ratio? What is the input information that's needed? You know, get the coalition, CDFA, UC around a table, and let's hash this thing out. Take some years to figure out what it is it's going to mean or what data you need first. And then the other thing is that we've got to figure out crop consumption for our crops, nitrogen consumption, many of which crops we don't know the answer to that. Almonds we know pretty good, grapes were pretty good, but there's a lot of crops we don't have good clear information on that. The other thing is that what we've got to have is we're going to collect this data is it's got to be comparable data. You got to be able to calculate it without being a PhD. It's got to be something that we can all do. And it's, you know, start doing some comparison between crops so we get some relative information on how this thing is going to work out. So what we've got to do is show that our nitrogen management is protective of groundwater. At the end of the day, that's all the regional board wants to know is the answer. Are you protective of groundwater when you use nitrogen fertilizer? So the development of this data collection, there's two main purposes, you know, so we can have this baseline information. Again, we've never had to collect nitrogen fertilizer information ever. On our farms, we really, other than university recommendations, maybe anecdotal, we don't really have a good sense as to what these what this baseline information is. So this collection will help provide that. And then it allows us to do regional comparisons, multi-year trends, and then helps address the probability of nitrogen leaving the root zone. I mean, again, back to this is their theme, is what's, are these practices protective of groundwater? And then the information from that will be used in outreach and education. We're going to be developing management plans. We'll talk about that later. And then we'll show areas that have high nitrate problems associated maybe with the nitrates that you use in the crops. The other thing, this seems like a simple deal, what's going to be the reporting unit? Because when you start comparing a million acres against itself and then our million acres against the other 6 million acres, what is the reporting unit? The recommendation was obviously do it with crops, but a little bit different on that we want to veer away from pesticide use is we want to go to the management unit approach. In other words, when I fill out a pesticide use report for my 20 acres, I have roads separating them. Each one of those then becomes a treatment block, and I have to record the information for that treatment block, even if I use the same amount on all those blocks. So the idea that we've come up with is you develop your own management unit. In other words, if you got 1,000 acres of almonds, you fertilize it all the same, you do one report. If you manage the 1,000 acres in 10 blocks, you do 10 reports. You don't split it up like we do pesticide use reports. If you want to do an individual field, you can do it that way. But the idea is be consistent, figure out a consistent reporting unit, and stick with it so it's an equal comparison over time. And then the other thing that they've backed us up on is report once a year. This is not going to be a monthly report like pesticide use reports. Do it once a year. Evaluate it on multi-years. Don't say 2014 is the year that we look at. It's a drought year. There's all these other things. So that we evaluate it on a multi-year basis. And then the other thing they acknowledge is we don't know what these ratios are, what they should be, what's the right ratio, is one the right one? It's certainly impossible to reach, but they did back us up again on the assertion that it's going to take a few years to develop what these ratios should look like. And then when you report back to us, the recommendation was obviously we need a field or a management unit location, the acreage, the nitrogen apply, and then eventually an estimate of the nitrogen removed. And there's a lot of things that are need to happen before that is being developed. And then a multiple years of data, minimum of 3 to look at trends. You know, this kind of stuff is what regional board looks at, is trends. They love to look at trend data, but you also need to set sideboards on it. Don't do a trend in 2 years. You know, give us maybe 5 years. This says 3 before you start making conclusions on what you're seeing. Then the biggest thing that just was a sigh of relief is that they did not say that we need to report irrigation. There is a lobby in Sacramento that wants us to start reporting irrigation applied water. And not only do they want to know how much you put on per season, they think they need to know the timing of these applications by field, which is just, it's insanity. You can't even imagine how complicated that would be to try to report the applied irrigation water. It's just, and then rainfall on top of that. So they said you don't need to include that at this point. However, with this whole drought breaking and Jerry Brown's latest bill, I frankly don't know how we're going to dodge that bullet over time. I think eventually they're going to make us do this. I don't know how they think they're going to do it, but they just see the need to report the amount of water we put on for some reason. So this, at least this expert panel said you don't have to do that. So we're going to be waving that in their faces for years to come. Now, there are two audiences for these nitrogen plans. One of them is that regional water board. There is this fundamental disbelief in Sacramento that we know how to fertilize. They think we throw this stuff on because we like to. It's kind of like pesticides, you know, we just put them on because they're fun or something. But part of this nitrogen management plan is to show them that we are fertilizing appropriate to our crop, to what we know from agronomic studies. So that's one of the things that we need to show. The other thing is that we're using certified crop advisors. We're in those areas where that needs to be done. High vulnerability areas, I don't know if I missed that, but that's when your high vulnerability area are going to need a certified crop advisor, a CCA, to sign off on your plan before your season starts. All the fertilizer sellers have CCAs on staff now, and the companies have been telling me they're going to be doing that for their customers. So it's not, I don't think, going to be too terribly complicated. Okay, the other audience is the members. The plan really, this template that we're going to put forward is a minimum bar. It's the minimum amount you do if you don't report. Many growers already have far more complex nitrogen fertilizer tracking systems they use. A lot of the fertilizer companies have these elaborate NPK, minors, majors, all the elements. That if you do that, you're fine. We just need the number for our reports. But what this template is for this, for someone that's not using any sort of reporting or tracking at all. So the information will, you know, that we collect will help these suppliers create a more elaborate whole farm nutrient plan. And then the timing of the information, we're pushing to have the first couple of years of this be nitrogen reporting only. Notwithstanding what I said about it's important to have crop consumption, but I think moving this ship just to get the nitrogen applied is going to be a gargantuan undertaking. Don't get us into a ratio business right off the bat. Just work on management unit, how much you apply, and do that for 2 or 3 years so we can get used to this system. So again, this is what we're proposing, now whether they take this or not. And then start the ratios in the crops where we have the information. Almonds is actually gone pretty far down this road already. They're funding research, the Almond Board of California, and they've got a pretty good sense of if you get 2,000 pounds of nut meats, this is how much nitrogen it takes to produce that. So they are closer than anybody else to say, okay, this is about a 1 to 2, 1 to 1 or 1 to 5, you know, this is what it takes. You go to other crops, I grow nectarines over in the Reedley area. I had no idea what 1,000 boxes of nectarines takes. I know what it is from growing them and from what my CCA says, but we've never done the studies like Almond Board to say, okay, here's your fruit, here's your culls, here's all the leaves, here's what goes in the tree. That's how many, you need this many pounds of nitrogen to do this. So that's the kind of work that needs to be done, that we're telling the regional board, let us get that done, and then we'll start talking about reporting a ratio. So this is what the template looks like. This is something, it's not finalized, we sent this in last week. It's a one-page sheet, very simple in its context on this side. This is your member information, the fields. I was talking about the management unit, you know, your crop, the year, member ID, that sort of thing. Production units, expected yield. So this is the kind of the production side. And then on this side is dry and liquid N, foliar N, other N fertilizers, organic manure, compost. So right here you have a total that says total applied N. So on this column, the CCA would say, all right, you get 3,000 pounds of almonds, that takes 250 units. So he'll say, this should total 250 if you have no carryover N or no N in your irrigation water. But if you've got 50 part per million water, he might say, well, this is 250. Why don't you back off to 200 because you're getting 50 units in your irrigation water. So this, he would, CCA would make the recommendation here in May or March, April, May, and then you would report here what you do. And then at the end of the year, next year, you total this all up and you send us this number and this information. So we then would aggregate that based on your crop and your management unit, give, again, back to the pyramid, then we give that aggregated report to the regional board and then begin to try to develop trends. So again, this is not too complicated. If you've got something more elaborate, that displaces this, but this is kind of like the minimum sort of a template reporting that would be used. And we will let you know, the December 4th Regional Water Board meetings, we're going hand-to-hand combat with Regional Board and the Environmental Justice Community. They don't like this at all. This is way, way too simple for them. They think it's got to be far more elaborate. So the Regional Board is going to have to decide that in December, and then we're going to, whatever's decided, then that's what's going to go out to members following that meeting. So here's a simple illustration. We got almonds here, grapes, this grower, if this is the same, could have that one report for the almonds, one for the grapes, two reports for that field. Whereas pesticide use reports, you know, I would have to do a, if I did Roundup in each one of these, I'd have one, two, three, four, five, I'd have six reports I would possibly have, or entries on my pesticide use report. So this, again, we're trying to make this thing as simple as we possibly can. Now, that brings to mind something I skipped on. We were talking about the task force. DPR, Department of Pesticide Regulation, and the county ag commissioners were there. They said they wanted to have nothing to do with fertilizer reporting. Don't even talk to us. We don't want to get involved in this at all. So if you wonder sometimes, why isn't the county ag commissioner? They said, no way. They're not going to, this is not their mandate. There's no funding at CDFA. So that's partly why you don't see any ag commissioner involvement in any of this. Okay, sorry, jump back. I'm jumping back to this. So then you take that number that we showed you here. You take this number down here, this information here. Then we go to this summary form to the coalition. We compile it on townships. That's a 6 square miles, aggregated by dates or by crops to give an idea of what are the applications made in that township. And then the communications that we'll give back to you as coalition members is we'll tell you in your township what's the average rate for almonds or whatever crop that is, what's the average rate per acre, pounds per unit of production, average amount of N in the well water. So we're going to aggregate and give you back an idea of what's your neighbor's doing. I'm not going to give you your neighbor's information, but we will give in a township basis.
What's the 12-month reporting period?
It's going to be a May to May. It'll be a May to May. So we need to have to you by May, Mike, help me on this, by May of this coming spring, the template. Next May 16 is when we'll need the aggregated information back for what you did in 15. So that's generally, that's for the, you know, the perennials. Citrus is going to be a little odd because they're weird, you know, because they go over the winter and that sort of thing. But, and some of these others, winter wheat probably have some adjustments, but generally it's going to be 2016 is when we're going to need that first information. And then, let's see, communications back, we'll give you that average information. Then the CCAs, hopefully you'll have a conversation with them and see if there's any ways they can save you money or improve quality, possible timing, placement changes, or maybe none at all, they may find out. This is what we proposed here about a year ago as a template, and it's pretty much the same of what we've gone forward. Nothing important to show on that. But what these reports are going to show in averages is, you know, generally what is everybody doing of my like crop in my like soil types in my like area. So there'll be the ability to see where folks are at. If there's outliers, people that are way above the application rate, this is a way we kind of chart them. You know, everybody in your area is about right here, and all of a sudden there's a guy way up there, or a few people, and this is just made up. But what these guys would be not the focus of regulatory enforcement. We're not going to send the water board. Nobody's going to send the water board out there, but we figure out maybe there's a legitimate reason they're up there using a lot more, or there may be overuse of nitrogen fertilizer. And the idea is that we try to move the curve in the direction that's matching application amounts to the crop produced. Okay, the other thing about groundwater, the tough thing about groundwater, the good thing about groundwater is there's nothing to inspect. You think about these people driving around in their pickups trying to inspect anything. This is going to be a paperwork enforcement effort. Unfortunately, we love paperwork farmers, right? But the good side is that it is going to be mostly a management plan based, reporting based. The only place these guys are going to be looking is wellheads. So they haven't told us specifically what they're going to be looking at, but I just know these water boarders, they drive around and they look for stuff to inspect. Surface water, they looked at the creeks. If it was muddy or if it smelled like manure water, they were upstream looking for the discharger. Groundwater, I think their only thing they're going to have to look at is wellheads. So put on a regulator hat and go look at your wellhead that's near a road and make sure that thing is as clean as, well, let me put it a different way. Make it so the guy will look at it and just keep on driving. But if you got a messy wellhead, if you got containers around it, if you got standing water around it, I took this picture on a field trip. We took some water boarders on and we showed, I shouldn't be using that, with the water board staff to show them some some water board staff to show them this. In this case, it was a buried micro system drip on tomatoes. They had corn this time. You know, we had fertigation. We had all this fancy stuff. And the guy zeroed in right there. And he said, you know what? What's that water? And it turned out it's the flush water. This guy's flush from his filters had been going there all summer long. It had algae on it. So you could tell that water puddle had been there for 3 months probably. He said, you get a spill in that fertilizer tank into that puddle, that's a saturated zone, and here's your wellhead right here, so it's maybe 10 feet away. He said that could be a direct pathway into your wellhead if you don't have a properly sealed well. If it's not, you know, the last first 20 feet is not sealed properly, I mean, I guess it's plausible that you could get direct contamination in that well from the nitrogen. So again, the point of this is make your wellheads look like they're something you could eat off of and not draw the attention of an inspector. And I don't think they're going to be out here in the next couple months, maybe in the next year. But over time, I can just see these guys focusing on wellheads, again, because there's nothing else to look for in groundwater other than the reports that we submit. And that's going to be, unfortunately, they're going to be box checkers. Did he turn his nitrogen report in? Did he do his farm evaluation? Okay, I'm going to take a breather for a minute, introduce Mike Johnson. Mike's been with us since 2003 managing our surface water program. He's going to tell you a little bit about the results and then also a little more about the groundwater program. Michael.
Thanks, Parry. So as Parry said, I've been working for you guys since the very, very beginning in 2003. My company also manages the reporting program, monitoring reporting program for the Delta Coalition to the north. And we also manage the groundwater program for the Central Coast Group. So we had a lot of experience working with agriculture and water quality. Like I said, we've been doing it a long time. And during that period of time, this program has grown enormously. To sort of give you an understanding of how it's grown, I used to be on the faculty at UC Davis. In 2003, early 2004, Parry came to me and asked whether I'd be willing to kind of help them out a little bit, write some plans and start some monitoring programs. And I said, sure. And it was just me. I did this coalition. I did the one to the north all by myself. The budget for the first year for this program was about, about $40,000 total. It was just me. Currently, I have a company of 26 people. Okay, not all of them work for this coalition. But for all of the coalitions combined, it takes 26 people to kind of keep track of all the reporting requirements, get all the monitoring data pulled together. We have people who all your final reports, your annual reports, are due every May 1st. So Parry mentioned our reporting years are sort of May 1st through April, whatever that is, April 30. We have people who turn in your final report on May 1st. We give them 2 days free time. And they start on next year's report. Okay? That's how complicated these programs have become. So I'm here today to explain to you a little bit about your monitoring program, why we do it, what the results are in general. And I'm going to go through a lot of terms. I'm going to talk about this last year, our reporting year. We've had a change in our program from corn assessment to corn represented. I'm going to throw a lot of terms out there. I don't want you to really focus on the terms. The take-home message is water quality has improved dramatically in this coalition over the last 6 or 7 years. And as a result, the monitoring that we do, despite the fact that it's still very expensive, is much, much less than we've been doing in the past. So Parry mentioned that your dues were $375 an acre and have held steady, and that you might even be able to go down a little bit next year. The reason is because water quality's been really, really good. And the reason water quality's been good has been because of your efforts, okay? All I do is collect the water. We send it to the laboratories. We get the results. We send them into the regional board. You're the ones that have actually been doing the work to keep the water clean. And you've been doing a terrific job. And I'll show you here how well in a minute. So. We're getting some air running through here. It's a little warm. So why do we monitor? We have to collect the water and compare the results to the regional boards or the state's water quality limits, objectives, standards. So the water board has set a concentration of a chemical in water that is the maximum allowable. So for a whole series of constituents, everything from pesticides to copper, lead, zinc, cadmium, ammonium, bacteria, and so on, the state has said, we will allow so much bacteria in the water. You have to collect a sample, analyze it. If your sample exceeds that, if the concentration, the amount of bacteria in that sample exceeds our value, you have what's called an exceedance, okay? That's a problem. So we go out every month. As a matter of fact, the guys are out today down here sampling, although down here they won't be doing much sampling because there's no water to sample. But we have to go out and we have to visit. There are four locations here in Madera County that we have to visit, and I'll show you those in a little bit. We then take collect the water where there's water to collect, send it off to the laboratories. We do chemical analysis for regular chemicals, pesticides, metals, nutrients, and bacteria. And we also do toxicity testing. In other words, we take a sample, we pour off a little bit of that water into a little tiny beaker, and we add either a little bit of algae, another beaker, we add what's called a water flea, which feeds on that algae. And in the third beaker, we add a larval fish, which feeds on the water flea. So we look at all the levels of the food chain for toxicity testing. It seems simple. It isn't all that complicated, but it's very expensive. So just for the monitoring portion of the program, just the analytical, just the money that comes from the coalition to the laboratories, I think for you guys this year, it's about $600,000-$700,000. That's how much it costs. That's actually much less than it could be. Again, water quality has been very good. The amount of monitoring has been cut back. So I'm going to show you the old system and the new system. And then I'm going to show you a table of sites. The old system, again, it's not all that critical to remember, especially since we no longer use it. But we had these things we called core and assessment sites. We monitored for all of those various and assorted things. Pesticides, sediment, water toxicity, metals, and so on. We also do what's called management plan monitoring. Parry mentioned the term management plan in his presentation. We have to do monitoring at locations where we've had previous problems. And problems are defined by the water board to be where we've had two or more exceedances of a single constituent within a 3-year period of time. So whenever we have, for example, one of the problems we used to have a lot of, we don't have much anymore, thankfully, is Lorsban. So the chlorpyrifos is the chemical, the active ingredient in the product Lorsban. When we found Lorsban twice in 3 years at levels above what the state allowed, we would have to go and put that water, wherever we found that watershed, into what's called a management plan. And the management plan consists of three parts. We have to identify the source or the potential sources of the problem. We have to demonstrate that management practices have been implemented to solve the problem. And then we have to monitor to document that problem has been solved. There's no more Lorsban in the water. And this has been, for us, an extremely expensive part of our monitoring program. And I'll show you why here in a little bit. What it means is that where we go and what we monitor from month to month changes. Our new system, we have now divided up our coalition region into 6 zones. Madera County is one zone by itself. The whole county is in one zone. We sort of jokingly call it the zone of no water. But there are 6 of them across the coalition region. And at each, we get to monitor at one site in each zone. The site that we monitor here in Madera is Cottonwood Creek. We have to monitor for a whole series of things, but we have a series of other sites in the zone that we might have to monitor. However, as long as the water quality is good, as long as we have no problems at our core site, we never have to visit our represented sites. Okay? So good water quality means very little monitoring. Unfortunately, we still have to do the management plan monitoring. So we're dealing with problems that we experienced back in 2004, 5, and 6, and we still have to go through and work on those and do some monitoring. Okay, again, the bottom line is we had lots of sites before. These were the sites that we did under the old program. You see that Stanislaus had 7, there's about 15 in Merced, and there are 3 sites that we've been working on in Madera County. This is what it looks like now with our new program. 2 sites in Stanislaus, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 in Merced, which is about half, a little more than half of what we were. In Madera, we still have the 3 sites. The problem is that the regional board won't let us leave those sites until we have 3 years of water quality data, but we haven't had 3 years of water. So there's no, we can't collect samples, we can't demonstrate that something's been cleaned up if there's no water to collect. So we have to keep coming back. We take a picture of the site every month to document that it's dry, and then we move on. But even still, I think you can see that there's far less monitoring than we used to, but again, management plan monitoring at a whole bunch of sites. So I'm gonna show you some exceedances from Merced County and then also from Madera County. There's a bunch of physical parameters, dissolved oxygen, pH. pH measures the acidity of the water. SC is a measure of conductivity. It's a measure of salt, amount of salt in the water. This says arsenic, copper. This is water flea toxicity, and this is fathead minnow. That's the fish toxicity. And you can see that there's fairly large number of physical parameters that we have exceedances for. Part of the problem with these measures is that they just naturally occur. When you're in the summertime, you don't have much water in a water body. It gets hot, the water heats up. It doesn't hold any dissolved oxygen. It can't physically hold enough oxygen to meet the state's standards. So we're required to monitor. We do. We dutifully every month turn in our exceedances and say, yep, we got another dissolved oxygen exceedance. And the regional board for all these years has been understanding, and they've said, fine, let's not worry about it. So they haven't really given us a hard time about those sorts of things. Arsenic up in Merced County in the Duxlu area is actually a naturally occurring contaminant. We find this at our background levels, but they're still higher than the state allows. We haven't had to do anything about that. Copper. Both in Merced and in Madera County, copper has probably been our biggest problem for 2 reasons. One, we find it a lot, and the other reason is we can't link it to anything that anybody applies. Lots of copper is applied, but we can't link it. We can't go upstream and say 2 weeks, 3 weeks, a month, 2 months, 3 months prior to when we detected the copper in the water, we can identify a series of growers that applied. Can't do it. Sometimes it's months and months between the last application and an exceedance. So at some point in time, we'll worry about this, but we're not going to worry about it right now. Toxicity is problematic because we don't know what causes it. But even still, you can see that at Devon Creek at Gurr Road, there were 2 fish toxicities last year, which means that site goes into a management plan. We have to go back out and visit and do a whole series of things. So this means, right here means more monitoring, and in Mustang Creek, we have to do more monitoring. Those sites have to go back into management plans. Here's Madera County. I know this is gonna be a big surprise to everybody, but every month of last year, they were dry. There was no water to collect. At Dry Creek, we had 2 pH problems and 1 copper, which in our estimation is really not much of a problem at all. And again, the regional board has allowed us to pretty much ignore these because they can't figure out the problem either. So as this program was getting sort of ramping up back in the mid-2000s, 2005, 6, and 7, we started to accumulate lots and lots and lots of problems. As a matter of fact, we had monitored at 24 different locations. So we had 24 different watersheds that we were collecting water from. Every single one of them was in a management plan for multiple constituents, multiple things. We realized very quickly that we could not afford either the time or the expense of dealing with all of those problems simultaneously. So the regional board allowed us to prioritize those watersheds from the biggest problems to, you know, the smallest problems. And so each year, starting in about 2008, we tackled three or four watersheds, depending upon the size and where they're located. So that's called our prioritization strategy. So I'm going to show you a couple of slides here, and it'll say first priority, second priority, third, so on. That means the first priority were all three watersheds we took on in the very first year, 2008. It's a three-year process. So in 2009, we started another three. 2010, another three, and so on. We've worked our way through. We're in our seventh priority right now. So we've gone through about 22 watersheds total, and we're just about done. Although, as you saw in the last slide, we pick up, you know, new management plan problems, and those things have to go back in. We've already prioritized our exceedances. We go in and we try to determine where the source might be within the watershed. So for example, this doesn't occur much anymore, but if lore's ban is a problem, we find lore's ban, it's a problem, we go back in and identify who applied lore's ban within about 2 weeks prior to when we sampled. All of those are potential sources. We don't worry about who is the source, we just say these are all the growers who might be a source. They're contacted. We've sent people out. Wayne, Zipser, Parry have done surveys. They've gone out and met with growers on their operation, gone over their operations. If there's a reason to suggest that another management practice might be appropriate, Wayne or Parry will do that. In general, actually, most operations are managing their discharges more than adequately. I'm going to show you some numbers here in a minute to demonstrate that. But the other thing that it triggers is we have to monitor for 3 years. I got this slide changed. It used to be 2 years, so a couple of these slides will say 2 years. But all of a sudden now we have to do 3 years of monitoring to demonstrate that the problem no longer exists. So up through the first five priority watersheds, we have completed everything. All of those watersheds have been addressed. All of the problems have been addressed. All of the contacts have been made. Surveys have been completed. So some of you may have actually completed surveys in the past and turned them back into the coalition. And we've done monitoring for at least two consecutive years, now again three, to demonstrate that there were no problems. And when we get to that point, we petition the regional board to get rid of those management plans. And this, I was going to say, we have this one here. Back in about 2008, I can't remember how many exceedances we had. We would have 12 or 14 exceedances of lore's ban every month during the growing season and a couple of months during the dormant spray season. Last year, we had one in the entire year. And that one, we traced back to a source that was not a coalition member. Okay. We detected it in our sampling. We had to notify the regional board that material was in the water at a concentration above what they allow. But the regional, we also documented that it wasn't one of us, wasn't one of our members. And the regional board says, fine, you guys are clean. So this won't have to go back into a management plan. Okay, so I mentioned earlier water quality is improved. So here's just two constituents. A quick demonstration. So you can see that back in 2007, this is the copper colored one, orange color is copper. This sort of turquoise, whatever color that would be, is the chlorpyrifos. And this slide is actually a little misleading because this is all in percentages. Over the course of time, remember we've been through all those first five priority, we're done with all those, we've gotten rid of all those management plans, which means that we have much less monitoring now than we did in 2007 and 2008. So this could be 70 or 80 samples. So over half of those samples back in 2007 had copper in the water at a concentration that exceeded the state's allowable level. We're now down to 12 or 15%, but we're only collecting 15 or 20 samples. So there's been a dramatic decline in the actual number of exceedances that we've experienced over the course of time. Chlorpyrifos, here's the chlorpyrifos numbers. This 4% that we had in January, September 2013, that's actually one sample. It's just we don't have to sample for that much anymore because the water quality's been good. And again, we reduce the amount of monitoring, okay, we reduce your cost. So I mentioned earlier that we go out and we've done surveys. This is for the first three priorities. We targeted growers who farmed 32,330 acres. The green bars are the number of acres on which adequate management practices were already in place. So you can see that for pest management, irrigation management, erosion, sediment management, almost every single acre was managed properly. Storm drainage was a little less. But the purple down here, okay, those are the number of acres that actually thought that they might need some other practice implemented to help control, in this case, storm drainage management, 1,659 acres. Not much. So this illustrates two things. This slide does two things. One, it illustrates that we are now able to go to the regional board when they say, where's your data? For years, we've been telling the regional board, growers manage their operations well. They control the drainage. Everything works great. And they've said, show us the numbers. So we go back, and we can show them this. The second point is that this is how we provide the information to the regional board. It's all aggregated. We provide no information on any individual grower, any individual operation, any field, anything. Everybody's sort of grouped together. It's all anonymous. And the regional board is perfectly fine with that because they actually don't want to deal with individuals either. As long as water quality is good and we can show them this kind of information, they're perfectly happy. Okay? And the reason we can show them this kind of information, these sorts of trends, and the fact that people are doing a lot is because you guys have done a terrific job. Again, all I do is collect the water, send it off to the lab. You guys do all the heavy lifting. You've done a terrific job. Okay. Like I said, we've finished all the way up through the first five priority sub-watersheds. Everything has been removed that we can remove, and this is the accounting of all of those pieces that we've been able to get rid of, all of those problems. So Lohr's band, the chlorpyrifos, we've been able to get rid of monitoring Lohr's band at 9 different sites. Diazinon at 2, and so on. You might say, well, you know, that doesn't look like a lot, but as far as dollars and cents goes, that's a lot of money, because that's a place we don't have to drive, bottles we don't have to buy, lab costs, personnel costs we don't have to incur to collect the sample, lab costs we don't have to pay, and there's a lot of work that goes on the back end once we get the results. All those results have to go in a database. We have to write them up and report them and argue with the regional board about them. So there's a lot of savings, a lot of dollar savings in those numbers. Okay, 6 priority sub-watersheds. We're sort of in the middle of those right now. We have compiled the list of growers that are adjacent to the waterway. You can see that there's one here, Ash Slough. Ash Slough has actually been on our list of priority watersheds for a long time. I think that we may have had water in it 3 times since 2008. On the days that we visit, I mean, I'm sure there may have been water in it other times, but there's just no water down here. We've had individual grower meetings that are almost complete, and we are in the middle of our monitoring. Again, guys are out today. The constituents for those, Ashley, was copper, nitrate, chlorpyrifos. This is the Lohr's band, nitrate, and algae toxicity. So copper, nitrate. Those are our big problems down here. Chlorpyrifos was a problem several years ago, but not so much now. Okay, now, so water quality is good. But what all the other requirements? Parry mentioned that you guys, I'm trying to stay out of your way so you can see. Parry mentioned that there are a whole bunch of grower requirements. You have to fill out your farm evaluation. There's going to be a nutrient management plan. For some of you, there may be a sediment and erosion control plan. There's all these things that you have to now complete in addition to all the things that you already do on your operation. What we're doing, this is sort of the tip of the iceberg. First of all, every time you turn in a report to us, your farm evaluation, we have to pull all that information together, aggregate it all, and then report on it and send it off to the regional board. So that's one of the things that we do. The other things that we do, so Parry mentioned that there's a groundwater assessment report. That was turned in last January the 13th. We received a conditional approval of that report, which is that thick, $250,000 to produce. The conditional approval required that we do some more work. That work was done by a consulting company called Ludorf and Scalmanini. They're specialists in groundwater. We submitted just last Thursday the update to try to get full approval for the groundwater assessment report. But the bottom line is the groundwater assessment report identifies areas of high vulnerability for contamination of groundwater. I'll show you the maps here in a minute. We turned in a surface water quality management plan at the same time. The regional board has had that for, 10 months now almost? And we still haven't received any, they haven't had a chance to read it yet in 10 months. But what it does is it identifies all of the surface water areas, all those watersheds with high vulnerability, basically where are their current water quality problems. And we submitted a sediment discharge and erosion assessment report on January 13th, and we're still in discussions with the regional board to try to get that approved. Once that's approved, that will identify areas that have a high vulnerability for erosion, and those growers will have to complete a plan, which they'll keep on their operation. It's not turned in, it's not recorded anywhere, it's just for them. Okay, vulnerability. The definition of groundwater vulnerability, after $250,000 and a year to collect all the data, because as Parry mentioned, it was a massive data dump. They collected all of the groundwater information, all of the recharge information, all the soils, everything from the whole coalition region. What they found was that high vulnerable areas are areas that have primarily shallow groundwater, sandy soils. Low vulnerability, deeper groundwater, heavier soils. Surface water vulnerability, that was easy. The regional board defined high vulnerability surface water as any place in which monitoring had indicated a previous problem. We had lots of previous problems. And sediment vulnerability. Sediment vulnerability is high percentage slopes, highly erodible soil, and long hillsides. Again, not very illuminating. I mean, I don't think that you need a PhD to kind of come up with that conclusion. Where are you going to get erosion? Pretty steep slopes that have highly erodible soils, no vegetation on them. Fortunately, this didn't cost very much money to do. We were able to get that done very inexpensively. Okay, so maps. Here are the areas in brown here are all of the high vulnerability groundwater regions as identified by the consulting company, Ludorf and Scalmanini. So you can see, if you're up in Stanislaus County, this is 99. There's the Modesto, sort of Sears Keys, down here to Merced, and then down to Chowchilla, Madera. This Fresno would be down here. So this is Stanislaus County, and Merced County is in here, and then Madera County, obviously, down there. So you can see that if you're west of the highway up against the river, almost everywhere in Stanislaus County is high vulnerability for groundwater contamination, and actually a fairly large portion east of 99 as well. As you move farther south, the vulnerability, actually, you don't have quite as much down here as you do up north. These areas here, these hatched areas, when part of our conditional approval was that originally these areas were not part of the highly vulnerable area for groundwater contamination. And the regional board came back and said, no, we think that they're vulnerable, put them in. So we had to go back and draw these things in. So that's groundwater, high vulnerability groundwater. Surface water, I think we can see this reasonably well. These are all the watersheds here, all this yellow, where we have management plans, and therefore the state has said these are high vulnerability surface water regions. Here's 99, So a good portion of the land east of 99 is high vulnerability for surface water. This is for sediment. All of these areas, so this is the Stanislaus, the Tuolumne and Merced rivers, all of these areas up against the rivers, and all of these little purple dots are high vulnerability for erosion. So run back through these real quick. High vulnerability, the brown, is high vulnerability for groundwater. High vulnerability, surface water. And I think you can see that between those two, you've pretty much got most of the coalition region as highly vulnerable for something. The exceptions are these areas down here in Madera County. Next steps, once the regional board has built a program based on whenever we get an approval for something, that triggers a whole new set of things that need to be done. So once the groundwater assessment report is finally approved, remember we have a conditional approval, once it's finally approved, we have to develop a groundwater quality management plan. That's due in 60 days. And in a year, we have to develop a groundwater trend monitoring program. So at some point in time in the future, we will be monitoring groundwater. We don't do that now, but we will at some point in time. But until the trend monitoring program is developed, we don't know where, how much, how often. Regional board would like a fairly substantial amount of monitoring, and we obviously don't want a lot of monitoring. We monitor the groundwater program for the Central Coast. I don't know if anybody in here has ground in the Central Coast region, Salinas Valley or Santa Maria down there. But we monitor their groundwater program. We just finished a year of monitoring groundwater that cost them somewhere in the vicinity of almost $1 million to do groundwater monitoring. So obviously we're going to try to keep the cost down and develop a trend monitoring program that satisfies the requirements but doesn't cost a lot of money. Also, Parry mentioned that there's a management practices, sometimes it's called effectiveness, sometimes it's called evaluation program. And basically what we have to do is to develop a set of studies that evaluate management practices to determine if those practices are protective of groundwater. The regional board can't come to anybody and say, you can't flood irrigate, you can't furrow irrigate. They can't tell you how to farm. All they can tell you is you can't discharge chemicals at concentrations higher than we allow. So one of the things we need to do is to make sure that we've documented which practices are effective. And that's that program. We have to start that program 2 years after the approval of the groundwater assessment report. So again, this is just the tip of the iceberg. This is the kinds of things we'll be working on here, along with all the annual reporting and that sort of thing. And with that, I will be done.
Okay, thank you, Michael. We're almost done here, so hang with me a few more minutes. Got a few more things to go over, just some of the deadlines. Farm evaluation reports were due last May. If you didn't get it done, please fill it out and send it in again. We're going to be sending out the follow-up here in a few months. And then we're trying to do these things on a multi-year, every 2 or 3 years. Right now they're annual, but we're working towards trying to get them done only once every 2 to 3 years because the information doesn't change that much. Low vulnerability growers are going to have a little bit more time to finish those. And then all these reports are going hard copy. We looked at going online, and the cost was not justified, even with the internet the way it is, because so few of our members like to use the internet for reporting. And then the farm evaluations, we're going to be mailing out that year two here by December 1. Most of them should be pretty easy for you if you don't change practices frequently. There'll be just boxes there that say nothing's changed. You can send it in pretty simply. And then the deadline to return those is going to be May 1. So next spring is when those need to be in. Now, just some of the data that we gathered from the farm evaluations from this past year to give you an idea of the type of information that comes out of these. The cropping, 44% of our acreage in the coalition is almonds, grapes, followed by grapes, pistachios, corn, alfalfa, walnuts. So a lot of miscellaneous pasture row crops and such. And then when somebody answered a question on an APN said it's almonds and grapes and didn't say acreage, that's what this indication is over here. But generally you can say, and I think we've probably known that intuitively, almost half of our acres is almonds now. The other thing that's a good piece of data that we're going to be able to show a lot is over 50% of the production area is now either under drip or micro sprinklers. Micro sprinkler 33, drip 32, so that's a good number. Flood is still, furrow and flood is about 21%, 9% sprinkler. Secondary irrigation practices wasn't that useful of information, but anyway, the story on drip and micro is good. And then practices for managing sediment and erosion control, not that big of an issue here, but in other areas where that is a problem, most of people were solving it by switching to drip, so they preventing off-site movement of sediment. And then some of the other information was a lot of nitrogen management practices being used. This is going to help us a lot as we do our try to do the management practice effectiveness work that's being required. But a lot of split applications, the most widely used split application, soil tests, tissue petiole fertigation, all those sorts of things that are good practices for fertilization. And then still a fair amount of work needs to be done on wellhead protection, I think. And part of this is just going to be notifying folks that these are the types of things that need to be done. And then the sediment and erosion control plan, we're working on that template. Madera County is not such a high priority with that, just unless you got ground over there right against the foothills. Most of the area is not going to need one of these. Again, this is kept on the farm, not something that you have to turn in. If there is an inspection, though, you're going to need to produce this. And I've been telling the folks mostly up north, any of that ground east of the Oakdale-Waterford Highway, fish and wildlife and water board are flying that. After every storm, they jump in an airplane and they fly from more or less northern Madera County all the way to Oakdale in the north, and they look for plumes of sediment. And I'm getting reports back, and they literally have a guy on the ground with a truck, and they're calling from that airplane when they see a plume of sediment going into a creek or a waterway, and they're going in and doing inspections. Going forward, they're going to say, show us your sediment erosion control plan. Now, one point, somebody asked me this morning, these big, huge storms are not that big of a concern. It's when we got a 3-4 inch rain, they know stuff's coming from everywhere. What they're looking at is what you would call a typical half inch, quarter inch rain. If there's sediment coming off in those sorts of storms, they expect most of that runoff to be pretty clean coming off of farms. So again, not so much something we have to worry about down here, but further north, certainly so. And then these groundwater management areas, Mike talked about those. I don't quite know what this is going to look like. We have these high vulnerability areas. We have lots of nitrates. Growers in those areas are likely going to have to fill in some surveys that's additional to farm evaluation, although I'm hoping what you have done already will be adequate. But mostly this is what is going to focus on wellhead protection. What are you doing around the wells to make sure that's not a pathway to the groundwater? There's no template for a groundwater management plan. We can't go to another state or another area and say, you know, what do you use for this? So this is another thing that's going to be developed pretty much originally from the coalitions and working with the commodity groups and such. We should know this winter. And again, I can't emphasize enough, look at your wellhead. Don't give them an excuse to stop. Make sure that wellhead is clean around it so that you don't attract attention. And then the management practice effectiveness. Oh my gosh, this is something that we're going to be working on this, I think, for 5 to 10 years. Because the studies, any of you have been involved in field studies, you know you can't do a study 1 year on a perennial crop particularly and come to really any solid conclusions. Fortunately, we've got all the coalitions from Fresno North are partnering together to fund this. And I guarantee you we're going after the fertilizer suppliers and getting them to throw some money into this. Because we, the growers, are not going to carry this whole water on this development of or proving that our practices are not causing contamination to groundwater. There's also some grants out there we're going to be looking into, try to get some CDFA and other grants to pay for this work. But it's going to be a complicated undertaking. Even the science of doing this, what we're trying to do, is not commonly known in the research community. I mean, we know pesticides, how to test pesticides. But nitrogen fertilizer, as we all know, it's not been regulated, good thing. It's not been regulated by EPA or anybody else. So nobody's had to do environmental fate studies on nitrogen fertilizer or any of the other things that are commonly done before a pesticide is ever allowed to be used in agriculture. So there's a lot of things, there may be even new science needed on the fate and transport, understanding nitrates as they move through that soil profile. Because soils respond differently, you got biological activity. There's a lot of things going on that are not easy to measure. And you look at the types of questions, you know, how many replicas we got to do per crop? How many do we got to do per field? How many soil types do we have to test? All these questions have not been answered yet. We propose to the water board what we think should be done. And then at the end of the day, we want to say these studies have to be practical and not break the bank, not be so elaborate and expensive that we're not going to be able to do them because of cost. We did, this other group I work for, CURES, got a grant from CDFA, and we actually went and did a literature study. Mike and his crew went out and looked at the literature of how do you test for nitrate movement past the root zone. I mean, we looked at papers in Europe, back east, everywhere that anytime there's been nitrogen problems, and there's just not a lot of technology out there to do these measurements like they need to be done to show that we're doing a good job. It's real basic. You get a trencher, you go down 4 feet, you shove an instrument down to 3 more feet, you collect the water that moves past the root zone. That gives you an idea of how much nitrogen's moving past the consumptive use zone of the crop. This lettuce field that we did the studies on, we found some, what I would say, pretty significant level. This was in Salinas Valley, of nitrates that were past the root zone, no longer available to the crop, that were likely on their way into groundwater. We had this was in Salinas. Then we had some field work that we did in Stockton in a walnut orchard. Same idea, digging down below the root zone and trying to measure what was going past the root zone. Well, we did see in this walnut orchard, it was a mature field. You can see there, tree-to-tree sprinkler. There wasn't much going past 4 feet. That root system in that walnut orchard is almost a solid mesh of roots. And you can imagine, you got a sprinkler system in a healthy walnut tree, it's going to take all that nitrogen that's applied and use it in the tree. So there was some, you know, it wasn't final data, but it indicated very promising that nitrogen, at least in this setup, is being used effectively. Last slide. Thanks for coming. Turn in your clickers at the door. Please do your farm evaluations. Appreciate you coming today.